Your attention, please. And now, on with the show.
Live from Paradise Studios in New York, Strong Island Television presents Under the Radar, starring Randy Unger.
Brought to you by Magnitude Jewelry. Add a two to match your attitude.
Tonight, we're going to be interviewing celebrated author Cassine Gaines. Randy will also be reviewing the new films Mary and Joker with special guest critics Erica A. and Thomas Puglisi. And now, here's your host, Randy Unger.
I have with us a renowned film and TV score composer, Mr. Bruce Broughton. Bruce, how are you?
Pretty good. How are you?
I'm good. Originally, we had someone else scheduled. I apologize for that confusion. We were going to have a wonderful author, Cassine Gaines. He's a great film author. We're very happy to have you on the show as well, Bruce. So, yeah, thank you for agreeing to do this.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's fine.
So you have an illustrious career in film and TV. You did the score to Homeward Bound, one of my absolute favorite scores. And another score I love of yours is from the movie Stay Tuned. I'm curious, you've had such a great career, such a long career. What are some of your personal highlights?
Oh, geez, I don't know. You know, when you're doing it, it's sort of like a job. Some of them are good and some of them are just difficult. I can tell you movies that I enjoyed doing. I mean, I enjoyed things like Silverado and Young Sherlock Holmes, Homeward Bound, Miracle on 34th Street, Rescuers Down Under. Those were all really great experiences. And there were a lot more. I worked with a lot of really interesting people. The music is, you know, slightly different from film to film, sometimes grossly different from films to films. But after all these years, I mean, you mentioned Homeward Bound, I hear a lot of people, mostly in their late 20s, mid 30s, who talk about Homeward Bound or Rescuers Down Under as being a film they watched a lot as a kid. So I think when I hear that back, that's sort of when the warm fuzzies come, you know, to know that people listened to it and were moved by it or had decided to do some sort of career thing because of it. That's partly scary, but it's nice to know that the music still gets heard and still gets remembered.
Mm-hmm. Now, how do you go about picking your projects?
By saying yes. Just saying.
that's a good start.
Yeah, that sounds interesting. I'll tell you, I've had kind of a hit and miss thing on that. There was one movie I turned down. I went to see it with my agent. And I didn't get it. I mean, I didn't get the movie. It had a big star in it, and I just thought they needed to do a lot more work. So I turned it down, and Jerry Goldsmith ended up doing it. So I saw it on a day that I was actually chairing or being the head of a talk, you know, for Jerry over UCLA, and he chose to show this film. So I looked at the film. I thought, "Wow, they made some great changes. This is really a cool little film." And the director was there, and the director said, "So, what do you think of the film now with this score?" And I said, "Wow, you've done a lot of work on it. You've done a lot of editing." He said, "No, that's the film you saw." Mm-hmm. So the film went off, and it did quite well. And I thought, "Well, there you go."
What was the film? I'm sorry.
It was called Hoosiers.
Oh my gosh!
Yeah. So, and then other films, you know, sometimes you take films you don't know how they're going to turn out, you know. Sometimes you think you've got a big hit and you don't. And other times, this little film that you don't think of too much, suddenly everybody wants to see. So, how did I pick them? I picked them mostly for my interest level, you know, if there was something in it that, or if there was somebody I wanted to work with like that.
Okay. Now, you mentioned Jerry Goldsmith. He's actually one of my all-time favorite composers, as well as you, sir.
That's okay. Jerry's one of my all-time favorite composers, too.
Yeah. What was your relationship like with him?
Well, I wouldn't say that we were pals, but we knew each other. He was... the first time I had to talk to him, when I say I had to talk to him, I was over in London doing a TV movie, and I came downstairs for breakfast, and Jerry's sitting there having breakfast with my producer. And the producer sees me, and he gets up, and he walks over to me and says, I'm done with breakfast. Here, sit next to Jerry and, you know, have breakfast. it was like, you know, when you sit next to one of your mentors or one of your heroes, it's kind of hard to talk. I think I must have, it sounded as though I had an IQ of about 45. But he was always very nice to me, and he was very complimentary. I understand he was even complimentary behind my back. I followed him on a couple of films. I followed him on Baby's Day Out. I followed him on Tombstone. I think it was his recommendation that got me the job. I followed him on the first big theme park thing I did for Disney.
Soaring.
No, it wasn't Soaring. It was way before then, years ago. A thing called, I'm at that part where I can't remember names or titles, but no, it wasn't that. It was a Time After Time,
okay.
The Timekeeper, and it had another name in France, but it was one of those Circle Vision things, and it was a great job, but it also introduced me to a great number of people, and through that, I worked for years over with Disney Imagineering. The last one I did was Soaring, and I did the revision. I did the update to Soaring because Jerry wasn't any longer available. And it was, you know, really, really a great thing to work on. I mean, I love that show. It's one of the best attractions they have in the Disney parks. And know that I was basically taking care of Jerry's stuff. Had Jerry done it, he would have done it.
Right.
I mean, had Jerry been around, he would have done it. So Jerry and I had a little bit of a relationship. I would see him now and then, and we'd stop and talk. And I liked him. I thought his music was spectacular. I mean, I told him this before he died. I said, you know, you're the only composer I know of who ever made me think I didn't know enough. Because you'd see his movies, and you could see what he was working on. You could see this is a Scriabin movie, or this is a Stravinsky movie, or this is a Strauss movie, or whatever it is. And I'd sit there and I'd think, man, I don't know this style well enough. I need to study more, you know. And you'd go back, or you'd listen to his music and you think, what the heck is that? What's he doing there? And you try to figure out, sometimes for months, trying to figure out a combination that he had made or some sort of device he'd use. He was a very, very clever guy. Also very good with film.
Right. And you guys, you actually have sort of a similar sound, if I may say.
Well, that's flattering. I would never have thought that, but that's flattering.
Yeah, you guys, you picked, you know, you were so diverse in the way you picked roles, films. You did animation, you did action, adventure, drama, and it always seems to work for both of you. You mentioned how you almost did Hoosiers. Looking back on that score, would you have done it any differently than Jerry, or would it have been kind of similar?
I probably would have done it a lot different than Jerry. Not to say that I know what I would have done, because I really didn't get the film. I mean, I really didn't. I just didn't see it as being cohesive, and you know, I wouldn't have known where to start. I mean, and one of the things I noticed when I saw the movie was that it just made so much sense. You know, that was just him. And I listened afterwards to his score to hear what he had done, and it was, you know, it was a typical Jerry score in that it was unique. And it didn't sound like a bunch of other scores he had done. He found his way in. And that was a big lesson for me.
Okay. Are there any projects that you're working on now that you can discuss?
No, not on a film or a TV thing. I mean, to be honest with you, I mean, I don't do as much of it now as I used to, but I've never known very far ahead what I was going to do. Sometimes I would think there was going to be a movie coming in a month, and then it'd be 2 months or 3 months or whatever. But often I would just sit and wait and see what happened. So there are a couple of things that could be happening or not. I don't know. In the meantime, I'm writing a concerto for harp and flute, so that's got me busy.
Now
I do a lot of concert works now.
Okay. Now I'm curious. So obviously you've done film and TV, and now you're doing you know, concerto work. How do you consider each format the same, or are they kind of different to you? How do you?
No, they're very different. I'll tell you. For a long time, I was primarily a film and TV composer.
Right.
And I would even call myself that way. And there's, you know, I don't mind that, because that's really what I was doing. I spent years doing it and worked hard at it and happy to do it. And I'm still happy to do it. But I realized that in between the films and in between the TV shows, I would write this other music. I was always doing it. 40 years ago, I was always writing a piece when I had a month or two, you know, in between projects. And I finally got to realize that I had done so much music of so many varying types in my career that I wasn't this composer or that composer. I was just a composer who had done a lot of different kinds of music. And that's the way I like to think of myself. I like to think that the technique that I gained working in the movies, especially the ability in things like orchestration and moving things around and timing and writing very defined things for defined purposes, helped me in my concert work. The biggest difference I find between the two things is that in film music, whether it's film or television or theme parks or animation or any of these things that's audiovisual, your role as a composer is not so much to provide great music as it is to provide help for the story. You're basically writing or entirely writing accompaniment. You're not writing the main lead. You're not writing the main voice. The main voice is the picture, is the story.
Right.
So you're there to help the story move a little faster, to move a little better, to make it a little bit more romantic, a little bit more sinister, a little bit more suspenseful, all those things. And when you've done it, the comment you want to hear more than anything else is from the director to say, yeah, that works. Anything other than that is not germane.
Right.
Whereas if you're doing a concert work, you're the whole thing. I mean, there is no primary voice. There's no movie to follow. You've got timings that you have to figure out yourself. You have to figure out the value of an idea. You have to figure out what sort of an idea you're going to use and how it's going to work in this piece and blah, blah, blah. You're creating something from the bottom up. Mm-hmm. And nobody's going to tell you, yeah, that works. You know, somebody's going to applaud or someone's not going to applaud. I mean, like, even with directors, if they don't applaud, their version of not applauding is to tell you that they don't like it or that they think something needs to be moved or changed or modified. In concert music is the same way. So there are different things at work. I like them. I like them all, actually, whether I'm doing a movie piece or a theme park or an animation thing. I mean, I like theme parks and animation. I think that's the most fun.
Right.
Or doing a concert piece, I just like to have them come out well. I like the variety in it.
Nice. And a director that I'm sure almost always applauds your work is Peter Hyams. I'm curious, what has been your working relationship with Peter?
Well, I'll have to say Peter was... let me just say really bluntly, I learned probably more with Peter than I learned with anybody, because he was very demanding. He wanted what he wanted. And he can be, you know, he can be hard to work with. He's not abusive. He's not asking you for things that you can't deliver on. He's got you here. He's hired you for a job. And if you don't do it up to what he wants, he'll keep going until he gets what he wants. And he expects that because you have the job, you will be able to do it. So one time we were having a problem on a film, and I gave him the option to, you know, to hire somebody else. And he looked at me and says, "That's not an option. You screwed it up. You fix it." So I did. You know, that was the job. I'll tell you, he's been very, 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 very specific about what he wanted. And I was talking about this with Mark McKenzie, who used to be my orchestrator. Mark and I were both working on Peter's projects, and we both agreed the same thing. He was hard and he was demanding, but man, you sure learned a lot with him, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So there. I other guys are, I don't know. I think Jerry said it's sort of like dating. I mean, you never quite know who you're going to be working with. Sometimes you have a great friendly relationship. Other times it's just strictly a working relationship. Other times it just nothing works. You know, it's. You both may as well be speaking foreign languages, but somehow you just have to get the job done, you know.
Right.
So, Peter was definitely worth working with. I am very appreciative of it.
That's great. So other than the great Jerry Goldsmith, what other composers or musicians have influenced your work?
Well, everybody probably. In the classical field, there, I will listen to just about everybody. I'm not a big pop listener. I would probably stop around the American Songbook. In film music, the composers that I really were stunned by were actually the older composers, guys like Alex North, who's at the top of my list, Korngold, Rocha, guys like that. Of the guys that I know and work with, who are around my age or around my time, or a little younger, I've always liked what Al Silvestri did. He and I used to do television years ago. He was doing Chips and I was doing How the West Was Won, so we used to run into each other all the time. I think he does a good job. I think he does a consistently good job. Yeah. I really like what John Powell does.
Oh, yeah.
I think John's score to How to Train Your Dragon is just spectacular.
That was his first
I like what Tom Newman does. I told Tom one time, I said, you know, the thing I like about your music is you come up with solutions that I would never think of. And you come up with solutions that I don't know why they work, but they do. I mean, it's just, it's like going into a whole new universe, you know, listening to his music. There are a few people like that from time to time. I liked, I don't know too much about his music, but I can't think of what his name is. The guy who did Arrival, the Icelandic guy. He was like a sound design guy, and he was really good. I mean, I listened to that, and I thought, wow, musically there's about five notes here. Mm. But, man, this is a good score. It's a really good score.
Johansson.
Johansson. Yeah. I thought that was really interesting. I mean, you know, for movies, I'll look at anybody who can tell the story really well. Mm. I've looked at the works of some of my students because I've taught for years off and on over at USC. Mm. And you know, a lot of guys have come through that. Marco Beltrami was in my class. And Chris Beck was in my class. These guys have done really well. Yeah. I watched a movie the other day that surprised me. There was a fellow from a couple of years ago who had done this score. And I'm thinking, wow, this is great. These guys are, you know, they're getting on. They're getting their own voice. They're getting work. So I'm standing in line there as being one of the people. I can't say I'm the main person, but one of the people who had some influence. At least I'd like to think so. Yeah. So, you know, we influence everybody. I tell composers, particularly younger composers, if somebody asks you how you did something, tell them. Hmm. Because we're not building bombs. We're only writing music, you know. And people need to know how things were done. Like, one of the big frustrations I find for people who like film music is that they can't find it. They can't find the actual music because the studios in general don't publish it. They don't print it. There are a couple of scores like Silverado's one, Matrix. Oh, there's another one, Don Davis.
Yep.
Matrix. A couple of scores have been published in book form. Hmm. But for the most part, they're hard to find. So if you're looking to see how somebody did something, like if you're taken with something like, let's say, Spartacus, mm-hmm. where are you going to find that? I mean, that's not published. It's not like going out and buying a Beethoven symphony, you know. I listen to everybody, and I like a lot of people. I listen to the new guys. Mm-hmm. Occasionally, I hear something that's really interesting. I haven't heard too much of this instrument in the last 20 years, and I'm not alone in saying that. I've heard a lot of film music. I call them film music geeks, the guys who are really you know, hot on soundtracks. I've heard them say the same thing. The soundtracks aren't quite as interesting. Mm-hmm. They're not as inventive as what used to go on 20 or 30 years ago when Jerry was in his heyday.
Right.
You know, and people like that, you know, you could get scores that would just knock you off your feet.
But I'm with you with John Powell. He's actually, I've been following him since 2001's Evolution, great score.
Yeah.
And all of his animation and even his dramatic work is really strong.
He's good. John's really good. One thing I like him enormously. I mean, as a person, I think he's just a great guy. Yeah. But he's very smart, and he's he just sort of zeroes in on the music. I don't know how he does it. He and I work completely differently. I sit at a piano primarily and work with a pencil. He sits at a keyboard and, you know, he plays it in. But somehow it just comes out spectacular, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's interesting to see what all the guys are doing.
Yeah. Well, Bruce, are there any other projects you want to discuss, or, you know, wish you best of luck with the concert work?
Are we coming up short here?
A little, no.
No, it's no, as I say, I don't know. I mean, I could be doing something in the next year or next few months. Or who knows? I hope not, because I want to finish this piece first.
Okay.
But no, after this, I've got a couple of pieces that are interesting to me. I do some teaching. I just got back the day before yesterday from a residency at the University of North Texas, which keeps me up on what students are doing. I'm also helping them a bit with their media, getting their media department and their music department together. That's a school that's, you know, putting things together really quickly, as more and more schools are. Mm. I think the need for media music is really interesting. Mm-hmm. I think there's going to be, I tell my students and I tell young composers, in 20 years, you don't know what you're going to be working on. You just, I mean, technologically, from the time I began to this point, things have changed so much that it would have been science fiction in the days when I began. The science fiction is still ahead of us. And the ways of being able to make music and the ways of being able to reach people, the ways you get paid even, are in the process of a lot of change. Mm-hmm. So I'm looking forward to whatever it is I'm going to do. I know that for the next 6 or 7 months, my dance card is full. Okay. After that, we'll fill it up with something else.
Okay. Well, Bruce, you know, we're located in Long Island, New York. Where are you? I'm just curious.
I'm in Pasadena, near Los Angeles. I'd like to say I'm in Los Angeles, but actually, I prefer Pasadena. We just moved here about a year ago and are very, very, very happy.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, we're on the opposite sides of the country.
We are. Well, you know, if you're ever in New York, we'd love to have you stop by the studio.
So, is this a, you have TV? And I'm looking at a picture here of a keyboard and baffles and microphones and a table.
No, that's the sound room.
Okay.
There were some technical issues in the beginning, but right now, if you were actually on the show's Facebook page, which is live, you can see me talking to you right now.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll be a disembodied voice.
Basically. But Bruce, I want to thank you so much for your time today. You're one of my favorite composers. Like I said, Stay Tuned is one of my favorite scores, one of my favorite movies. So I want to thank you so much for your time speaking with me today.
Thank you. Yeah. I enjoyed the talk.
Great. All right, we'll talk soon. And yeah, be well.
Okay, Randy, you too. Thanks.
Thank you. All right, guys, so we're going to take a short commercial break, but we'll be back right after this.
Under the Radar is brought to you by Magnitude Jewelry. Add a tude to match your attitude. Patent pending interchange genuine gemstone and crystal EMF protection jewelry. For more information, please visit magnitudejewelry.com/gemgirl or call 718-268-6634.
Hey guys, welcome back to Unger the Radar. I'm your host, Randy Unger. And with me today is a wonderful panel of critics. Ladies first, Erica A.
Hi, glad to be here.
Yeah, welcome back.
Thank you.
Yes, and Mr. Thomas Puglisi.
Yeah, it's good to be back.
Yeah, guys, this is great. Your first time at the new set. What do you think?
It's okay.
It's okay. All right.
Yeah. I would say so as well. It's okay.
Yeah.
I think I prefer the couch.
But oh, you prefer the couch? It's a little more comfortable out there?
Yeah. But let's jump right in.
Okay. I'm just curious what you guys think. your opinion counts, not just with movies. All right, guys. So we've got two films today. We've got some time. We've got about half an hour or so. First movie is a horror thriller called Mary, which stars the great, the Oscar-winning Gary Oldman. And basically, it's about him and his family who set sail on this small vessel only to encounter ghosts and other kind of creepy, spooky happenings, a haunted ship, as you will. And my opinion, I did not think this was a great movie. I saw Gary Oldman's name attached. I was intrigued. I love his work. He's a great actor. Ladies first, Erica.
I think you used enough time to explain the movie that now we don't even need to see it.
Yeah.
That's about as much time as you need to give this ridiculous movie.
Yeah, ridiculous.
The end is obvious from the beginning. And
well, no
yes,
spoilers.
I'm just saying, and I'm not a horror person, so maybe my opinion is slightly negative to begin with, but interminable and ridiculous, and the boat seemed pointless in itself.
It's a haunted house on water, basically.
That's
yes,
what I was
it's
pretty
a
much
boat
thinking
that bites
well.
Back.
Thomas, you're obviously a big horror buff. I'm curious what you thought of this one.
I just also thought it was just like all right as well. I mean, like it's wasn't anything special.
Right.
Like, you know, I do agree with what you said. Like, you know, Gary Oldman was like the thing to see in this.
So been there, done that.
And Emily Mortimer, who plays his wife. She's actually a really good actress. She's an English actress. She's done a bunch of dramas. But yeah, for me, it was Gary Oldman was the selling point.
But I also did recognize the oldest daughter, Stephanie Scott, is the actress name. She was in Insidious Chapter 3.
Okay.
Yeah. So.
Stephanie
Scott.
Okay. There's a few Scotts in there, actually. Anyway.
Actually, those are the producers you're looking at.
You're right. Those are the producers. All right. We've got Owen Teague as the love interest of Stephanie Scott. Yeah. So, yeah, this movie, it was really lackluster. I'm very sad.
No,
I mean, like, it should have been longer, because I noticed it was barely even an hour.
Should have been shorter.
Should have been shorter. Yes, make it a short.
Please.
Yeah, maybe that would have been better. I mean, the scares, for one thing, were just terrible. It's just like jump scares.
Or non-existent.
Jump scares. Yeah.
You know, this movie, it just came to mind that this kind of reminded me of another thriller from the early 90s called Dead Calm. You might know of it. With Sam Neill and Titanic guy. He was a Phantom.
Oh,
Billy Zane, who plays the killer. He's stalking this couple on a ship. A small vessel like this one. But yeah, this is just... Don't, guys watching at home on your devices, do not watch Mary.
Just let's torpedo it right now.
If you're a diehard Gary Oldman fan, I guess still skip it. Because it's not... Yeah, it's really not that redeemable. I'm curious though, are there any other films that this horror film reminds you of?
I mean, it kind of reminded me a little bit of this movie called Ghost Ship.
Oh, Ghost Ship, yeah, I remember. Early 2000s, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that wasn't very good either.
Yeah.
Better than this though.
Yeah, I would watch it over this. This is pretty much just a low budget version of that movie.
Yeah, and that's not saying much, unfortunately. Alright, so I guess... We're good with Mary. We can move on.
Well, we're never going to be good with Mary.
No.
Okay.
No.
Yeah. So all of us agree, don't see it.
Yeah. Don't skip it. Skip Mary. All right, guys. So the more interesting movie and the movie that this will warrant much more of a discussion, I'd say.
And I think we all dressed for.
Yeah, we did. We are DC. We're representing DC Comics right now because we are about to discuss Joker, the new adapt version of the classic Batman villain. See that? Yeah. There he is. And basically, we've got Joaquin Phoenix in the title role as Arthur Fleck, a man tortured by society. He can't seem to cut a break. He's bullied, he's abused, he's mentally unstable. It's actually a tragic character. And basically, he, without giving too much away, he seeks vengeance on those who wronged him, on society, basically. And this is a really new take on Joker, on the character of the Joker. And, you know, I was blown away, and I think this is one of my top three movies of the year so far. Erica, what did you think?
I thought it was an impressively done movie. Mm-hmm. It offered a lot. I understand where everyone is coming from, that there are plenty of people who aren't going to be able to understand it or appreciate it, or even be able to sit there long enough because they're going in there and they want more superhero. Mm. But this is not a superhero movie. It's not a comic movie. Mm-hmm. It's a DC movie, yes.
Yep, yep.
But
yeah.
And it does do one key point to make sure we understand it's a Batman movie.
We've got...
We'll get into that in a moment.
You don't want to get into it now.
Should I?
I mean, no, we can save it. Okay, we'll get into it.
Okay.
We've got
this problem that every Batman movie seems to think we need Batman's origin. In case we don't know what happened.
It's a sad thing.
Here we go. Bang, bang, pearls fall.
Mm-hmm. Popcorn.
It's like... Okay.
We know Thomas and Martha Wayne get killed in an alley, and then that creates that starts the origin of the Batman. Yep. So yeah, we know what happens to Bruce Wayne, and that's a side plot in this movie.
It's not even a side plot. It's a little side note. Just a little variable they throw in.
This is all about Arthur Fleck. This character goes through so much. It's heartbreaking, and yeah, this is the first time I've actually felt for the Joker. Like, I felt sorry for this villain who's responsible for so many deaths in the future. Thomas, what did you think of Joker?
Oh, absolutely loved it. I mean, like, this wasn't just like a new take on the Joker, like what you were explaining. This is basically like a whole new take of like the universe. I mean, every like Batman movie that's been made before has always been like represented as like an action movie. Mm-hmm. This was no action movie. This was a crime drama.
Yeah.
So it was a very...
Thriller. I'd say crime drama thriller mesh.
No.
No? Okay.
Yeah. Right. No. I'm sorry. Continue.
Yes, Thomas.
Yeah, so it's a whole new take. I mean, it's like one we've never seen before.
No. Nope.
So like, and I really liked that it went a different direction that we've never seen before. And heck, this was a different kind of movie for the director, Todd Phillips, because he's only directed comedies.
Right. He's done Road Trip. The Hangover Trilogy. Yeah. What else am I missing?
Old School.
Oh, Old School. Yeah, these are all like frat pack style comedies.
When someone thinks Joker, they're expecting a comedy.
I know.
So the joke's on them.
Oh, that should have been on the tagline, on the poster.
Yeah, jokes,
jokes
on you.
Jokes on you. I like that. That's, yeah. Damn it. Yeah. Warner Brothers, do not steal that, please.
That's all Moi.
That's her. Yeah.
But something I also really liked was the detail they gave Gotham City, because like the look was almost like the look of, like the 70s or
70s, 80s, yeah.
Yeah.
I like
heck,
that.
I've never seen like that kind of like style since like the Burton Schumacher Batman movies, because they like were being filmed on sets.
Yeah.
They weren't being filmed on like real cities like the Nolan movies.
The first Batman was filmed in England in the Pinewood Studios.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. The second one was filmed in some scenes in England, some in Los Angeles.
Right.
And with, the third and fourth movie were also filmed in Los Angeles.
That's an interesting point you bring up, because the location, the setting of this film, it kind of grounds it. It feels like it's real. Like it grounds it in reality.
Yeah.
You know, it feels like the late 70s, early 80s. There's like tape machines, answering machines rather. And I love the look and feel.
And the cars are the correct shape.
Yeah. And it's kind of got this like classic, like this sunset, eternal sunset in Gotham City feel. Like it's always like kind of orange, in every scene. But aside from the visuals, I think we got to praise the great Joaquin Phoenix.
Yeah.
Who delivers another fantastic performance. I've loved his work since Gladiator. And
if we're gonna go
Walk the Line, he was really good in
Signs, great role there. Whatever, Erica.
No, I was just gonna say that's like he was already established. He had many early roles.
That was one of the roles that I never heard of him before that. Really?
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
What do you know him from?
Oh, I've never been good with names. I'm not gonna butcher movies.
Okay, fine. But I think we can all agree that this was one of his best roles.
Yeah.
It was new take on his career to revitalize it in a way that he's been sort of forgotten, I believe, in this decade.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, he should pretty much like get an Oscar or at least get nominated for an Oscar.
Right. No, I think that's going to happen without a doubt. I hope it does anyway, because he definitely deserves it. If not a win, for sure, a nomination.
Yeah.
I
also really did like the look they gave the Joker in this one, because it reminded me of three Jokers. Cesar Romero, Jack Nicholson, and Heath Ledger.
That was actually the next topic I wanted to bring up with you guys. Since 1966, we've had numerous Jokers. How old are we? About five now? Five-ish? Six-ish? Over the decades, who are some of your all-time favorite Jokers? Erica.
Well, I'm going to say the gold standard is Mark Hamill. So.
Okay. Well, vocally, yes.
Yeah.
Vocally.
But just he embodies it.
That voice, it does transcend sound.
It's the standard. I mean, yes, you have to have a costume designer for live action. Mm-hmm. And his outfit, his makeup, it was all so Joker-esque. All it was missing was a little flower boutonniere.
Yeah, here he is.
Even if it doesn't shoot acid or laughing
so
gas.
So little. He's so little.
Where's the magnifying glass when you need one?
Yeah. So, all right. So Hamill is your favorite Joker.
Of all time.
Cool.
Well, heck, when I used to read comic books, I always would vision his voice coming
out.
That's true.
And when they sell toys now, it sounds like him. It sounds either like his voice. I have a friend whose son was small, and they had a little voices that came out. And I said, that is perfect sound.
I think when I was a kid, when the first Batman came out, I think that was my favorite Joker. 89's Nicholson.
Yeah.
When I would actually play with my Joker, I think I would actually envision Nicholson Keaton's voices while I was doing little battles. But Nicholson for me is for sentimental reasons, obviously, I just mentioned.
No, I love him as
a Yeah, he's
Yeah, I love him too.
You know, cuz he was the first take in 23 years?
20 At least.
More?
Yeah.
Definitely more, I'd
Yeah,
say.
Yeah.
Yeah, 23 years.
Yeah, the movie the 66 movie was and then 89. So that's a while for no Jokers. So, actually no, they had the Super Friends the cartoon show.
And they also did a live action series.
In the 80s?
In the 70s or 80s. It's very terrifying. It only had two or three episodes.
I think I know what you're talking about.
Yes.
Actually. Oh. Is that the Superhero League? I think it was called.
Something like that. And Adam West is back.
Adam West.
Really? Live action?
Black Canary, and they have the Riddler back, and a Solomon Grundy.
It's How bad was it? It sounds terrible.
The most terrifying thing. If you have never seen... Oh, it's two? I thought there were three. You probably are right, but though.
I'm pretty sure it's two episodes.
Go on YouTube right now.
If you have
never
seen it, you have to see this. It's the most terrifying thing.
Had Ed McMahon as the host.
The second one.
He would just... Yeah. Oh, like the narrator, Gotham City.
The second episode wasn't about them fighting them. They sort of were in the studio afterwards.
Okay. That is odd. But for you, Thomas, what would you say is your all-time favorite Joker?
I mean, I feel like, as much as I really love both the ones you just said, but I'm going to have to go with Heath Ledger.
I
mean, whenever he was on screen, I just couldn't keep my eyes off the screen.
Yeah.
I just... really remember the pencil in the eyeball.
Oh,
the,
God. Want to see a magic trick?
Yeah. I also just really like the fact that since it was only makeup, he was able to, get through, the cops for, that scene where he hijacked the funeral.
Uh-huh.
And also...
Or the scene where he's in the cops' graduation, and he doesn't have any makeup on, but you still see his scar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And also, how he was able to, basically sneak into the hospital and blow it up.
Right. It's crazy. His portrayal is just legendary in terms of film performances.
Yeah.
Really.
So if Joaquin Phoenix gets this Oscar, he'll be the second actor to win an Oscar for playing the Joker.
Right. Well, yeah, Heath, sadly, he passed away.
That's why he won. And
he won posthumously.
I believe he won because he had died. Otherwise, he would have just been nominated.
That might have helped
Jack
his chances.
Like Jack Nicholson,
who
was nominated, I believe, but didn't win.
I don't think Nicholson was nominated for 89 Batman.
No?
No.
Okay. I'm pretty sure it was nominated for some Oscars with the art direction or the visual or something like that.
Yeah. It should have won for best score because it's one of the greatest film scores ever.
Oh, yeah.
We just had Bruce Broughton on. He's a great composer. So I think he might see eye to eye with me on that one. But this movie, it's just... It's so good. It's so.
I don't know if good's the right word.
It's intense.
It's intense. I'll agree with you there.
And it may make you feel like it may turn you off to the whole idea, but even if it does, it's not a feel good movie.
It's not its purpose at all. It's supposed to be a visually aspect movie. It's supposed to make you think. It's supposed to make you question the world you live in.
It's art.
And
It is. I say it's art.
Yeah. I mean, heck, I can relate to some of the stuff because I myself was bullied when I was a kid.
Okay, so. Yeah.
So it makes perfect sense. Like, yeah. I've dabbled. Yeah, people have. When I was in junior high, I had some issues. And I feel for Arthur Fleck. I really do.
You know, too.
He's just a poor guy. He's trying to get through life, you know, without being beaten up and, you know, harassed.
Yeah.
Walking home from work or even at work in the opening scene. Not really a spoiler. He's a sign twirler in the street. And
well, that's in the trailer, I believe.
It's in the trailer. It's a spoiler.
So yes.
From the get-go, you see that this guy is bullied and tormented, and it's really sad.
And there's no place for him to escape.
No, not except behind the makeup, in a way.
Yeah. Matter of fact, something I want to add is that the Joker is considered the second greatest villain of all time.
Oh, okay. Who's number one?
Darth Vader.
Darth Vader, okay. And what list is that off of?
Well, I saw it on like a list of like on the E! Channel years ago.
Okay.
That sounds like E! I believe TV Guide puts him... It's Darth Vader is like two or three.
Joker is number two. Okay.
Yep, number two behind Darth Vader.
Interesting. So, guys, I'm curious, in your minds, what makes a good movie villain? Erica.
Someone who does an evil deed.
Oh. All right,
there's
simple.
There's nothing worse than a wannabe villain who can't seem to pull off an evil scheme and gets knocked off.
Oh, so someone who actually follows through.
Yes.
That's good. I like that. Thomas?
Well, I think someone who can, like, you know, do, like, you know, a very good performance.
Sure.
As well as also, like, you know, just make the role their own. Mm-hmm. Just
but
like
that's
what
the role. That's a character, not a villain in itself.
Hmm.
What makes a villain?
Yeah.
The villain.
That is
and
over-
not the antagonist
overlap
or
there.
The protagonist.
Overlap. Yeah.
Well, or the anti-hero.
I think for Heath Ledger, though, he kind of, like, the line was blurred, like, beyond anything. Because he basically, he had passed away right after they stopped filming. And he was
filming another movie, though.
He was,
but that's what built the hype.
But he was. What I'm saying is, he was transforming into the character. He was becoming the Joker.
But all of them have always said that the only way to play the role is to fully transform in depth and build on it and engross their whole life in it.
Yeah.
As you've avoided a Joker, which I think got a lot of scrutiny over the last few years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I could also say like maybe like the character being relentless could also be a good villain as well.
Mm-hmm. Sure, but to actually, have your mind set to it and just, Darth Vader. With Darth Vader though, he turns out no spoiler. Well, this is a spoiler, but you've seen
40-year-old movie.
Yeah,
I mean like everyone's got to seen it at least or maybe at least one time.
Anakin Skywalker turns out to be a good guy. I mean he
was always the good guy. That's what the three prequels are.
He started out good, turned really bad, and then when he was on his deathbed, basically when the Death Star was blowing up.
Yeah, but he just had anger management issues.
Yeah, so does that make a great villain? I don't know.
But it's the whole package.
Yeah.
And that's what Joker can bring, and whether this movie has the whole package or it just has the build-up.
Yeah. Gotcha. All right, guys, so we've got some time left here. Do you see this Joker, this universe, blending into Robert Pattinson's Batman or any future Batman stories? Do you think it has potential to do that?
Well, personally, like, maybe they could do a sequel to it, but in a way, I kind of don't want them to, because I feel like this was good as its own movie.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think...
It said all it had to.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think they should make a sequel or even, like, a spinoff. I mean, we don't need a spinoff with the Bruce Wayne in this movie, like...
Right.
Because we already, like,
know Batman.
Well,
unless we do a spinoff to a whole different villain, getting a whole story of itself.
Yeah.
But I believe that... I agree. No, they have to leave this movie be. I think this movie does what it needs to. I think that Jerome and Jeremiah would have been equally proud of it in their origin.
Nice. I've never been a huge fan of Todd Phillips. I liked Road Trip. I thought it was funny. I had no idea he had this in him. This is a great movie, and this is probably the best in his filmography so far. So I want to see more of his work in the future. This was a phenomenal film. And a standalone. This just stands alone by itself.
Yeah,
it's long. It's 2 hours, 2 minutes. It says a lot. And also, guys, we have a few minutes left. I wanted to mention that there are strong similarities and overlaps here with a movie from 1982 called The King of Comedy, which is basically a similar story about a guy played by Robert De Niro, an aspiring comedian who basically kidnaps a talk show host to try and be to get his 15 minutes of fame, and he does so by kidnapping De Niro, who's De Niro's held at gunpoint in this, and that's a Martin Scorsese film. If you haven't seen The King of Comedy, 1982, check that out. It's awesome. It's very, very similar to this. And like I said, there's serious overlap with that with these two films. Okay, guys, so we've got 4 minutes. Are there any plugs that you guys have? Anything coming up you want to talk about?
Not right now. No,
you're good?
I think you're excited about something, right?
Yeah, like I'll promote my friend Michael Ciani's next retro picture show, which is coming up this Saturday at the Cinema Arts Center. There'll be a double feature of Halloween 2, the original Halloween 2, that is, starring Jamie Lee Curtis and the late Donald Pleasance.
More of the Night He Came Home, right?
Yep, More of the Night He Came Home. And Silent Rage, starring Chuck Norris.
Silent, what was that? I'm assuming it's an action movie. I've never heard of it.
Yeah, to be honest, I've never seen it either, So it's going to be my first time seeing that. I've seen Halloween 2 many times.
I'm telling you, the Cinema Arts Center, they got some good programming there.
Yep.
I think, part two, Mr. Matt Roran, who's been our show many a time. He's a great guest.
Good friend of ours.
Yeah, he's very cool. And the Cinema Arts Center, they're really great films there. So check those out.
Yep. These two movies will be shown in 35mm. I just want to add.
Nice. For all you film enthusiasts out there. Yeah. And did you want to mention anything about your friend's t-shirt company? Or?
Well, he actually just released a couple of new designs for Halloween 4 and Halloween 5 for Gutter Garbs. So some pretty good designs.
Cool.
And just in time for the Halloween season.
Sweet. Is this one of them or no?
No, this was just one we were doing for the Joker.
This is just a Batman-related t-shirt
ones.
Fest. I love it.
Yep.
Cool. Well, guys, we got 2:20. Okay. We're always looking at the clock here, but, we're having fun at the same time, so it's a weird little... some sponsor plugs from Magnitude Jewelry, a wonderful sponsor. October 18th to the 20th is the New Life Expo in the New York Hotel in New York City. And then in November, we've got the Naval Expo in Tarrytown, New York, as well as the Heart Freedom Expo in Chicago, Illinois. So stay tuned for more details regarding those. And guys, I just want to mention real quickly that this was our first show back after 2 weeks. I was at New York Comic Con 2 weeks ago. Awesome. Had fun. Except for the crowds. That was a little annoying. So, if you've never been to Comic Con, just be aware of the crowds. It's a little nuts. And actually, last night, I just came back from the New Jersey Horror Con and Film Festival, which was also awesome. Actually, even more awesome than New York Comic Con, if I may say. Yeah. And there's going to be some interviews that I did with some talent at the event. You're going to just stay tuned for that as well. That'll be on the YouTube channel soon. And we have 1 minute left. So I'm just curious, are there any films that you guys are looking forward to in the next couple weeks?
I'm curious about Little Women.
Little Women? Okay,
yes,
cool.
I mentioned.
Are you a fan of the original book?
I'm a fan of the book, and I'm also a fan of several of the other makes of them. The one from the old cinema, the one from the 90s, which I think most of us would have grown up on.
Yeah.
Amazing cast.
I remember Winona Ryder was in one of them, right?
Yes, that one.
94.
Well, there's Winona Ryder, there's Kirsten Dunst.
Okay.
There's from My Teenage Life, and she does the show on whatever.
Okay.
Okay, so.
Yeah. But yes. Thomas, 20 seconds left. What do you want to see?
Terminator Dark Fate.
Good one. All right.
Huge Terminator fan.
Yeah.
And been a fan of that ever since I was a teenager.
Oh, sweet, sweet. I actually met Edward Furlong yesterday.
Oh,
interviewed
cool.
him. He was cool. Okay. All right, guys. So thank you, Erica A., Thomas Puglisi. Thank you. You're always welcome here on the show.
Yes.
And we'll be back more Under the Radar next week. I'm your host, Randy Younger. Take care.
Under the Radar is all new next week with more movie reviews and interviews on Strong Island Radio and Television. Stay tuned. We'll see you next week.